Our November 15th JEA Board of Directors meeting. Please stand as I call this meeting to order for a time of reflection and the pledge of the flag.
Thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
Welcome. Again, nice to have everybody with us. I'd like to make sure the board members see the agenda in front of them with a few changes from the one previous one, I think, maybe. Right there in front of you. We have agendas at the back of the room if anybody would like to have one and doesn't have one. And if you would let me have an adoption to, a motion to adopt the agenda as amended, I would appreciate it.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. You've passed the amended agenda. We'd like to have a safety briefing from our CEO, Paul McElroy. Paul?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Safety is the number one core value at JEA, both for our employees and public safety. In the event of an emergency and we are called to evacuate, you are responsible for your safety buddy on your right and ensuring that individual does get out of the building safely. We will exit by the elevators to the left. There is a stairwell. We'll go down the 19 flights. We'll go slowly. We will hold the railing all the way down, and we will gather on the southeast corner of Main and Church. We'll be careful when we cross the street. There are fire extinguishers at the back of the room. We'll use those only to exit the building. Restrooms on the left. Everybody, please turn your phone on off or silent. In the event we need CPR or emergency rescue, Mike Brost will be responsible for that, and Ted Hobson will ensure that security is here to help us should we need that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. We'd like to ask our Chief Legal Officer, Jody Brooks, to give us a Sunshine Law public record statement, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is a properly noticed public, open public meeting. Minutes are being taken, and a quorum is present.
Thank you, ma'am. I would like to call on Dr. Johnny Gaffney before we have our public hearing. He has to leave to attend a city council meeting, and he is Mayor Lenny Curry's liaison, and we would like to hear from him today. Dr. Gaffney, please step forward.
Yes, thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I really don't have a whole lot to report today other than I apologize. I have to be, duties calls me to be in Rules Committee with the council, so, but I just wish you all luck today, and I know we're going to have a great civil meeting. Thank you for all you do.
Thank you, Doctor. Anybody, any questions of Dr. Gaffney? Thank you. Appreciate it. We have our presentations and comments section here, comments from the public on action items. This is not related to our other public hearings. So if you have comments for items on the agenda, we'll save that for our other two items on the agenda. Right now, this is a public. Do we have any cards from anybody here? We have three cards here. Do these three people understand the purpose of this is for public input at this point, not related to the agenda? Okay.
If you will, Mr. Chair, during this meeting, there's going to be three opportunities for the public to speak. The first opportunity is for the public to speak on any action items coming before the board that's not related to the public hearing on the rate issue.
Right. Jerry Malott. Is Jerry here? Let's see, Jerry.
Jerry will be at the public.
Jerry's going to talk on the rate issue.
He's going to talk on the rate issue. The public. He'll be at the public hearing for the rate issue.
Okay, that's the rate issue.
That's the rate issue.
Why don't you hold that? Dave Bruderly? Dave? Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
His subject matter is policy.
Yes, sir. I am standing here before you as a professional engineer who spent my entire life working in the energy industry, including helping siting and license Crystal River 4 and 5 and a number of other energy projects. And I am also very much concerned about the issue of greenhouse gas pollution and its relation to climate change. I first gave you a presentation last spring when you proposed to revisit your net metering rate for the rooftop solar. And at that time, I proposed a five-point plan that the board authorized staff to pursue. I want to dust that off and reintroduce it to you again. The reason I'm here, if I may, the greenhouse gas situation is getting worse. I'm pending out a paper I wrote 19 years ago that basically everything in that paper has happened. Greenhouse gas levels are continuing to increase exponentially, and we just had a near miss with a hurricane called Matthew that caused over $300 million worth of damage to our coastal community, trees falling on homes, just in the public infrastructure of beach erosion and so forth to correct the problems that we've seen. In addition, there are hundreds of millions of dollars of damage to private property. There is a relationship between greenhouse gas emissions and the climate. That is pretty much accepted by just about every scientist on the face of this planet. The Paris Accords that were proposed back last spring are now in effect. They went into effect about a month ago. Virtually every country in the world is looking to the United States for leadership. Now, we are in a situation policy-wise at the national level where there is, you can best describe it as highly uncertain as to what national policy would be with respect to this issue. So I believe that the responsible action for any conservative, liberal, progressive, Democrat, Republican, whatever your political persuasions might be, would be to take a business approach and a risk management approach. And my recommendation to you, and I'll hand out my five-point plan again, is that you authorize your staff to begin the process of developing what I have called a 21st century business strategy for JEA that will help us transition to a 21st century energy economy for your entire service territory as well as the rest of Northeast Florida. JEA is the only entity in this community. The Navy is also can be a player in this, but you are best suited to actually lead this process with a public stakeholder-driven process where you bring the various components of the community together, just like we did on the Alternative Fuels Master Plan that the Jacksonville Northeast Florida TPO did. Bring the transportation sector, the building sector, the logistics sector together, and one, recognize that greenhouse gas pollution is an issue, is a problem, and an opportunity, and then help your community understand the problem and then figure out how to address that problem. The first step in my five-point plan is recognition that greenhouse gas pollution is related to climate change and that it is a problem. And I think you are the people best suited in this community to bring all the elements of the community together, the city, the military infrastructure, which is very sensitive to sea level rise, very sensitive. The Pentagon's already pointed out that Mayport has a significant problem. And bring the elements of the community together so we can be proactive. And that will also, by the way, if we do it in a comprehensive manner, help the water and wastewater side of your utility address the issues such as the pump failures you had due to power service interruptions and bypasses and that sort of thing. So let me leave you with this plan, and I recommend that you consider this for action and with a recommendation that your board begin the process of implementing this plan or something close to it.
Mr. Bruderly, may I ask you a question?
Yes, sir.
I assume you live in Gainesville still. This says no. you lived there 23 years. Is that correct?
I moved here to Jacksonville in 2009.
Oh, so you live in Jacksonville?
I do.
Yeah,
I
for
the
record, it wasn't on your card, so I wasn't sure.
Yeah.
And you are a JEA customer.
Yeah, I am. I live at 1221 Molokai Road and on the south side in
okay.
the Grove Park subdivision. And I am a JEA customer.
Okay.
And I want you to use my money in the most cost-effective way possible. And I want to extend the life of your solid fuel unit because, frankly, if you all lead by example, given the uncertainty at the federal level, I think you can actually get emission credits to extend the life of your fossil fuel units if you can offset those with emission credits from helping the rest of the community do things that are cost-effective, like make bigger use of alternative fuels such as natural gas for ships, locomotives, heavy trucks, and electric drive, solar, even solar electricity for your light-duty vehicles. That these technologies are now available. They work. The issue is not the engineering. The issue is not the science. The issue now is policy. And how do we choose to invest our money, and how do we choose to spend our money, and how do your customers make those decisions? And my position is you all are in a position to really move this agenda forward to break through the gridlock that we now are going to see in Washington. Again, this has been going on in my world for over 25 years. This gridlock has got to come to an end. We have to move forward.
And thank you, sir.
That's why I'm standing here today.
Any questions of Mr. Brutley? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
We have one more card. Shelly Thies. Shelly
Thies.
Ah. Did I get that right?
Close enough. Thies.
Close enough. Thies, okay. Sorry.
Shelly Thies, native Jacksonvillian, 192 DeVoe Street on the west side. Thank you, JEA Board of Directors and leadership team, for allowing me to speak on behalf of Mr. Pete Wilking, who was unable to attend today's meeting. As we all know, 2016 has been an interesting year, to say the least, in terms of solar policy debate and discussion. Much has changed in terms of technology and the economy with respect to renewables and energy storage. It's also clear that all Americans, especially Floridians, support solar power as a clean form of energy to power our future. The current reality is that the electric utility industry and the emerging rooftop solar industry have not been in agreement on many recent policy changes. We have waited to see the result of Amendment 1. We see that it failed to pass, falling short of the required 60% approval. This puts us right back to where we were before. I'm expecting that the JEA team is now reconsidering the proposed solar policy changes originally planned this past spring for another try. If this is the case, I would like to suggest that this time JEA take a different approach. Jacksonville is a very capable, talented, and willing community of stakeholders in the green community that would like to be part of a new solar policy development team working in concert with JEA executives. Wouldn't it be a great thing to ensure that JEA's next solar policy revision be completely supported and endorsed by the stakeholders that are most affected by these changes? I would argue that we have much common ground. Formulating an intelligent, long-term plan with supporting policy is key. We in the solar community do agree that changes in policy will be necessary moving forward, and ensuring fair and reasonable measures is in everyone's interest to power our city into the future. We plan to discuss this matter with the U.S. Green Building Council in the hopes that they will agree to serve as the point of contact in forming a special committee or series of workshops to serve with JEA for this new solar policy development team. Mr. Pettway, do you see this as a good idea?
I appreciate you being here today, ma'am.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Okay, we'll move along to item number 3. The consent agenda. We have 5 items on the consent agenda. Is anybody, everybody?
Councilman Anderson. Greg Anderson's come here. Chairman.
I'm sorry, I didn't see Greg come in. Councilman Anderson, I apologize. You please come forward and.
I apologize for being a few minutes late. And thank you for this opportunity. Good afternoon. On behalf of Council President Boyer and the members of the Jacksonville City Council, I want to thank you again for your service to this community. Mr. Chairman, I want you to know that I know you have a heavy agenda today, so I will only say that your management team has briefed me, and I think most of the council at this point, on your revenue and rate stability program, which I think you'll take up today. For my part, I see the advantages of the plan, including a reduced cost, utility cost for our citizen, rate stabilization for at least 5 years, improved financial condition resulting from $190 million debt reduction. So I want to thank you, and I look forward to the discussion today. Also, directors, I want you to know that your management team has briefed the council during a recent shade meeting regarding the ongoing labor negotiations, and they answered our questions. And finally, Mr. Chairman, I believe the board passed a resolution regarding the number of board meetings that you are considering And if this is the case, and you wish, so I will brief the Rules Committee regarding your requested legislation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. We appreciate you being here and appreciate your comments. Anybody have any comments on the consent agenda? The five items on the consent agenda?
Move approval.
Have a motion to remove and approve. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Thank you for approving the consent agenda. We'll move to 3B. We have a strategic discussion from Mr. Brian Boche. Brian? JEA Sewer System Framework to Resiliency.
Good afternoon.
Welcome.
Good afternoon. There's a handout, 14-page slide presentation on the subject here. And just 6 weeks ago, the first week of October, we, the utility, the local state government, and the community were ramping up plans for Hurricane Matthew. Today, with the current lessons learned, JEA is enhancing the plans in the sanitary sewer system for the next hurricane in a multi-step framework to resiliency plan over the next year, and we'll go through that. We have 10 minutes, and we'll spend the next several minutes on the next two slides that go through the multi-step plan. I want to recognize the five directors in Water Waste Water in the third row back there. So we've been working very aggressively in their team over the last 5-6 weeks to put this together. So today's focus is mostly on the first two steps. Hurricane Matthew assessment report will detail sanitary sewer overflows. We'll include the history and benchmark. Typically, that is done in blue sky events, not the gray sky hurricane event. And then we'll report out on major capital improvements, significant O&M activities that we have both in the last 12 months and the next 1, 2, 3, and even up to 5-year plans. And then in April, we're going to focus on analyze, plan, and implement improvement activities. These are the kind of quick hits that we work on. We're going to review and improve all functional response plans. Those are operating guidelines for emergency plans. We're going to fortify our sanitary sewer system power supply systems. So there's 1,375 pump stations. We're going to look at each one of those and see what we could do to fortify those. We'll look both short-term and long-term, and we'll identify other actions to be implemented. Primarily, most of these items will be done within the next year, and some of them might take a little bit longer than that. And then in May, we're going to perform a system capacity management operation and maintenance assessment. In the industry, that's called a CMOM program. CMOM programs are typically in the industry focused on blue sky events, but it does touch a little bit on the gray sky, but we're going to validate that our system is operating well on the blue sky events, which we believe we're, you know, best of class on the normal operating periods. We are looking for that to have a comprehensive review, independent source. We are working with FDP as we speak, and we hope that they might even take the full leadership in that program that we'll work with them. And then finally in December, so approximately a year from now, we want to, the final step will be a system resiliency assessment. We'll be also working with DEP on that and potential for state leadership in this. There are several utilities around the country have made some, mostly studies, maybe some minor, maybe build a seawall up in D.C. has like a 13-million-hour investment, but the industry has not moved that much in action here. So we're looking at maybe we could take some steps ahead and we might actually be a leader in the country on this. We plan on conducting this in three phases, both immediate opportunities. This could be like generator plans. We'll go through some of that in today's report, mutual aid enhancements, and decisions on current projects that were taking place right now. We'll make mid-range defensive decisions, a sense of potentially elevating or moving electrical equipment to higher grounds or up in front of a plant versus normally wastewater plants are built where the discharge is on low-level areas. Pump stations are often built near low-level elevations. We might look at revamping that and potentially build some storm barriers. And then longer term, looking at the design standards for our utility and potentially other utilities to build a higher new resiliency standards. Ongoing, we have communication improvement opportunities. We have many stakeholders, and we'll look at anything we can do to improve the communication on both near-term and longer-term on such issues. Regulatory opportunities, I think the key there is FDP partnership, and Mike Hightower's group has taken the great leadership in that. We are engaging in the FDP rulemaking process on a 90-day emergency rule that we'll touch on that the governor put in place on September 26th. FDP helped us return to normal operations in October. Basically, after 1 week, the utility return to normal operations, with less than 1% of customers lost water sewer service during that week. And then the whole month of October, we worked with FDP to clear all water bodies that were impacted by SSOs to return to their, make sure they were returned to their normal pre-storm conditions. And we'll continue to work FDP on the CMON review and potentially resiliency standards. Wanted to go through that in detail. You know, we do have only 10 minutes. So the next slides will kind of highlight, and we'll be back for more anytime comments are welcome. This is a, the book's back, we worked our whole storm assessment. I meant to bring on the table. We looked at details, the team did, every single SSOs, the benchmarks, governor's 90-day rule, and this is just a highlight of a lot of that information there. The capital improvements, we mentioned the 12 months back, and each 1,375 pump stations. We started looking at the higher priority ones at this point in time on high flow, but by the next 6 months, we will look at each one of them, look at site reviews, what we can do on electric supply, whether it's tree trimming, improving controls, and looking at generator requirements. The next slide is an interesting slide on showing flow rates. You basically look at 1,375 or four quadrants. We have 350 pump stations that are small flow, less than 10,000 gallons a day. And the right-hand quadrant ranges anywhere from 50,000 gallons to 16 million gallon a day pump stations. JEA has 240 generators across these 1,375 pump stations. Arguably across the country, probably to have the largest number of pump stations. Maybe the city of Houston might have a little bit more than us with the same similar footprint. When we looked at this, we have 240 fixed generator installations. That's on, most of them on the right-hand side. For example, it's highlighted that there's 133 of the 151 largest pump stations in flow have fixed generators. So in a few slides down here, we'll look, those 18 that are, do not, we're gonna look immediately, see if we can fortify and put generators in a retrofit. And then the second quadrant, or one opportunity at this point in time, we have 85 portable generators and diesel pumps to utilize during a storm condition for the next 350. So we're going to look at that. Is that adequate amount to handle that situation? And then the bottom half of flows, typically they do not have generators, both at JEA and most utilities. And typically you look at things that were pre-storm, how to prepare for that. So the dotted line across shows you where the generator spectrum is, where there's very few at the left and almost a solid line on the right. Which pump station had SSOs? The red dots represent the SSOs related to pump stations. There was 55 of the 67 SSOs were related to pump stations. And it's across all four quadrants. And there was, of the 120 generators that were activated, over half the system was activated with the power outages at over 700 pump stations. So 120 generators were activated and 9 did not operate. And I say generators, really a generator system. There's a generator, there's a switch, there's VFD drives, there's breakers, relays, and it's a whole system, and it's something that we need to make sure they're all synced up together. Different manufacturers have different requirements. So we had 9 of the 120 that did not activate. The next slide highlights 35 pump stations that many of these were constructed many, many, many years ago, purchased from other utilities, but they're built now. They would have followed in one of the two criteria, the force main, discharge force main greater than 12-inch, or typically a more stringent rule that Duval County uses and JEA has been following for the last 15 years. If there's 500 gallons a minute at peak flow or greater, which is equivalent to, it's actually 441 gallons a minute, 500 equivalent residential units. And if even those conditions are met, a new pump station would have a fixed generator. So these stations were built beforehand, but we're looking back at this point in time and anything we can do to retrofit them. We believe most of these can be retrofitted. Some of them may require purchasing land, may take longer than 6 to 12 months to do it, but we're immediately looking at this. The ones in yellow had SSOs. The number 2 was a high flow station, and our team is looking as we speak to put generator system on that one. We're looking, talking with Paul, we need to figure out how to identify these new regulations that come in play. Similar to you might have on the electric side, if a new regulation comes, make sure that we go back and relook at our system every so often, make sure we're doing what we can to meet newer regulations. Reportable SSOs, especially with the governor's rule, all appointed elected officials and the board has receiving the reports of SSOs. I want to go through real quick the different type of SSOs. So the first type is reportable through FDEP, and they're one of three requirements with the three bullets. Sewer spills of any volume that reaches designated waters of U.S. That could be 1 gallon hitting a tributary. Sewer spills greater than 1,000 gallons or threatens the environment or public health. The perfect example of that one, you could have 5 gallon spill in front of a shopping center front door. That threatens the environment, even though it's less than 1,000 gallons. And then also FDEP reviews all SSO with JEA on a quarterly basis, and we submit an annual report. So on right is the chart showing the reportables where, for example, in FY16, we had 42 reportable SSOs. The chart has a hash mark. Those are the total, and then the ones below the hash mark and ones that hit U.S. waters was number 32. 32 hit U.S. waters, 42 reportable. The bottom half are non-reportable SSOs. So traditionally, until September 26, these were provided at local DEP only for information. They were 50 to 99 gallons. They were not to the state watch officer on a 24-hour notice. And the ones below that are non-reportable SSOs. The FDP was not even asking utilities to know about these. These are 5 or 10 gallon type spills or clogs. So we had 116 of those. One thing to make a point is no matter how big or small they are, JEA performs root cause analysis on them. Even when they weren't reportable, we always perform root cause analysis. I'll have to move through quickly here. The next slide is representing SSOs to U.S. water benchmarks. And the reason we're showing this is traditionally the top two slides are in the board op report every month. And that shows the 32 that we had in FY16, the average of 30 in the last 8 years. Before that was in the 50-60 range. And before that even in the 100 range. And the volume. And those are the benchmarks typically across the Least Florida Benchmark Consortium. It shows U.S. waters. On the bottom left is the root cause analysis on these, where the last 5 years, pump stations were 13% of the root causes on SSOs. And the little chart shows in FY15, there were only two to pump stations, and FY16 to one. So in blue sky, pump stations have pretty much been taken out of the situation of SSOs as the root cause. And the bottom right is our benchmark compared to other utilities in Florida, where JEA is operating per 100 miles of pipe. Of course, us and Miami-Dade, the largest two utilities in the state, were operating second most favorable on the amount of volume the last 3 years on blue sky events. This is just a summary of the governor's rule. Requires notification to the Environmental Protection, the highest ranking local elected appointed official, general public. So the board and the stakeholders and the mayor has been receiving these since September 26. We put in place a process. The emergency rule is a 90 days, and then we expect the effective long-term rule. We were engaged with FDEP, and whatever the rule is, JEA is going to continue to comply and work aggressively to make sure the notification is out there. It is noted there's no threshold in the current rule, so even 5 gallons on a grass right-of-way or reclaimed water are getting reported at this point in time. Capital budgets. Highlight in the top left shows that we started picking up the capital budget. You know, when growth started in the development in 2012, 2013, in 16, we spent $44 million on wastewater collection and pump station funding. And we have over $250 million in the next 5 years just on wastewater collection and pump station. On the right highlights several key projects, $14 million to Southside River Crossing, which is a 42-inch, 45-year-old ductile force main that was installed this year successfully. 5 million gallons a day of sewage. We're so glad that it came in on a 45-year-old pipe. We're looking at three major pump stations, McMillan, Alachua, and Bradley, getting rebuilt as we speak for $20 million. And the bottom, we have a large diameter condition assessment and pipe replacement program, about $10 million a year in the next 7 to 10 years. And that is really looking at a real focus on transmission level type of force mains and pump stations. This is just a picture. The crossing that went through the Jaguars parking lot. Top right is a series. The reason there's a series of projects, Memorial Park, Lane Avenue, Timaquan, of pump stations and pipes. So you have 5 or 6 major projects making up $20 million on the west side that we had several SSOs in this area that will replace older pipe, larger pump stations, improve generation, and the electrical controls, and overall provide more capacity in the area. The bottom left is the Fifth Street pump station that overflowed, the largest one that did not have a generator. And graphically, it's a pretty tough environment to get a generator pad in there. My folks think they can get it in. We might also need to look at buying some land next to it. And this slide is a picture of a generator on the top right, a VFD, a variable frequency drive in the middle, and relays related to mechanical pump seals. And really to focus on, it's a complex, today's world of pump stations aren't like they were 20, 30, 40 years ago, especially the large ones. A lot of electrical equipment, not only outages, but electrical faults, power, voltage sags, and we need to have an opportunity to increase the synchronization between those, the fail safes and what have you, and we are working on that as we speak. And to summarize, today was the report on the hurricane, our capital, and we're going to come back in April and May and look at our CMON program and December of our overall system resiliency plan. We have ongoing work on communication and regulatory. Apologize for going over time and speaking a little fast, but I want to make sure we did cover it. Any questions?
Take a deep breath.
Oh, thank you, sir. I get a timeout?
Yeah, you get a timeout. You did a good job. I told you not to worry about the time. This is important. You did a good job of overview, and it is certainly a five-year plan, and certainly it's going to take a lot of money. But we've identified septic tanks before the storm as a problem, and with the city, we have dedicated $30 million to that problem. Is there any overlap between the problem, as we've outlined it, and septic tanks and the funding of the two problems? Is that one problem, or is that two problems and two funding requirements?
I believe they're two, and they're two different funding, and the magnitude's so much significant on the septic tanks. If there's 55,000 septic tanks in town, and approximately a quarter are failing at this point in time, and we've estimated over $500 to $700 million to resolve that as a community. There's immediate things that we can do on the SSOs that are in the tens of millions. Now, certainly if a utility like JEA wanted to build it for the next 100-year storm, it could range in those hundreds of millions of dollars, a septic tank, but I believe they are separate. One thing I was thinking about today, we normally have our meeting on septic tanks with the city this afternoon, and Melissa and I are going to miss that one for the board meeting, is there are times where people look at putting low-flow pump stations in lieu of gravity systems, and if you had a storm, if you have a bunch of low-flow pump stations that customers own, you could have a lot of problems on site. It wouldn't be the utility's responsibility, it'd be customers. So I think when we get rid of septic tanks, we've got to think about how we're going to do that most effectively. We don't compound problems, turn the SSO problem to a private consumer. So there are some relationships to it, certainly.
Well, I guess what I'm concerned about for the board's, from the board's perspective, we've got the problem identified. We'll come up with a solution, and funding is the key.
Yes.
And we're talking about a lot of money for both of these problems. And I guess we'll get Paul to speak to that in a minute. But I'd say you need to keep in mind the responsibility that we have for funding and help us understand how these two vital projects do work together or don't work together, because we have a tendency to think of it as one problem.
Okay. Paul, Melissa, this slide is in our capital budget and our rate plan, and we have a lot of funding. You see the increase from 25 to 44 to basically $50 million a year on the collection and the pump system.
Right.
A lot of this is on the transmission level, the larger flow ones, and we have added a few line items in, $5 million electrical liability. That's for quick fixes. So we think we can do a lot of mitigation of what happened in this storm with funding that we have available. We started the $10 million a year large diameter pipeline. Will it solve all SSOs? No. I'm not sure how much money you could spend to solve all of them, but we think we take a big chunk out of it with what we have in our plans the next 5 years. Now, if we raise it up when we come back in December to much higher design standards, higher than anything the wastewater industry is doing around the country, that would be in the magnitude of numbers that you're talking about, Mr. Petway. And that would be a serious funding issue. And I think it's not just us, that the whole industry would need to be raised on that.
Well, infrastructure is everybody's problem, and we understand that. So We just don't want to let it get ahead of us.
Yep.
Any more than it already is.
Yep.
Paul, you have a comment on the funding side?
Well, I think as Brian pointed out, I think they're separate. I think in terms of going about this, attacking this issue in a deliberate fashion, identifying the short-term issues, working those through quickly before next storm season so we're prepared or better prepared. And then secondarily, we've got some intermediate activities that we can shore up and benchmark and make sure through the CMOM process, working with FDEP and the governor's office to ensure that we have the best and most reliable, best performing sewer collection system. And then long-term, as Brian points out, I think that is where we build towards a more resilient system with a change in standards, and that's a bigger issue. And long term, we'll end up costing more. We'll have to work that into the plan.
Anybody else? Any questions?
I have a quick question, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Howard.
Brian, I didn't see in the materials presented if there was any sort of a triage or prioritization strategy in the framework for resiliency. And maybe I just missed it, but has your team, and by the way, congratulations to your team responding quickly with this initiative. It's very important to this board, obviously, and to our community. But can you identify what the factors are that you would prioritize spending to address the system vulnerabilities?
Yeah, I think the first one would be the size of the flow rate. And this slide shows the 151 pump stations that are greater than 500 equivalent residential units, 175,000 gallons a day, because that way, if there is a spill, you want to make sure you address those issues. And then there's subcomponents of that. And the last slide, the electrical systematic between the VFD drives, the relays. We're learning some things that we do. We normally fail close a seal, mechanical seal. It says if it fails, you want to turn off the pump. Maybe that works good in blue sky events because you don't want the motor to get damaged. But you find out how often does that really happen. Maybe we need to fail it on versus off. So there's things we could do on subcomponents of that or prioritization on the large pump stations. I think the work on the large diameter pipe assessment, Paul started that 3-4 years ago, had us, I missed my capital budget one, that $10 million in the bottom right. The large diameter and the large pump stations are the most significant ones. That would be a prioritize.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Very, very well. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. All right.
We have item B2 next, a public hearing to consider modifications to the electric tariff documentation, adjusting energy charges based on rate class and the implementation of new economic stimulus rider. I would like to... We're going to have a presentation, and we're going to have a input from the public, comment from the public, and I would like to start with comments from the public from Mr. Jerry Malott. Mr. Malott, please come forward.
Thank you very much. We're very pleased, and my name is Jerry Malott, president of Jack's USA Partnership, executive vice president of the Jack's Chamber. In our efforts to grow the economy here, what you do here at JEA is critical to what happens, especially to larger companies. The proposal you're about to consider today is very pleasing. It lowers everyone's bills in our community. But from our perspective, what it does that's very important is allows JEA the flexibility to work with large electric users to negotiate and be more competitive in how projects are brought to our community. It has a very positive impact on large industrial users, whether existing or new, and generally will make our community more attractive at a time that I think is very important for us to be. And so it directly affects job generation, capital investment, and of course, electric use and use of your capacity within JEA. So we're urging you to move forward positively on that. We're delighted that you've put it together and are considering it and think it will benefit our community a lot.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Malott is president of Jack's USA.
Yes,
sir. The economic development initiative in the community on behalf of the Chamber of Commerce in the city. We thank you for being here and appreciate your input. The public hearing is open. If anybody else that we don't have any cards, we'd be glad to have it entertained. I had one card. From Mr. Malott. Do we have anybody else from the public that would like to speak? Well, we'll move to Melissa Dykes. I guess we need to close the public hearing.
No, the presentation will...
Be part of the public hearing.
That
don't make you nervous, does it?
No, sir.
Okay. Please proceed. Melissa Dykes, our CFO.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon. The strategy proposal that we're presenting this afternoon to the board is the culmination of a year of work by the JEA finance team. And it consists of four different approval components. There is the component that falls within the public hearing, which is the component that touches the JEA electric tariff. There are three separate action items outside of the public hearing that are all part of the strategy and all work together to enable us to execute on this plan that ultimately will keep rates stable for our customers in the electric system for at least the next 5 years on the base rate side. And will allow us to save $100 million for our electric system customers over the next 8 years. I'll quickly just walk through the components within your binder of the public hearing materials themselves. We're behind tab 3A in the binder. And if you'll flip behind that tab, what you'll see is a summary document of the agenda. Then there's an agenda item that summarizes the plan itself. Behind that is the resolution, and the resolution is what, if the board approves the actions taken within the public hearing, it's the document that is actually approved by the board, and it's the one that enables us to enact the tariff changes within the electric system tariff. Behind that, there's a red line of the tariff itself, and there are, I apologize for the number of pages here, but it is quite lengthy as a red line because we touch every single electric system rate. And so as you go flip through the red line, you'll see just the number rate changes for each of our rate classes within the electric system. And then at the very end of the red line, there's a more extensive red line area where we talk about the economic stimulus rider, which is new to the JEA electric system tariff. As part of the public hearing, I'll just quickly step through a summary of the information that was presented to the board back in September. And this outlines the plan that was developed by the finance staff. When we started down this road, we really started with the objective of knowing there were some changes in JEA's electric system cost structure that were coming our way, knowing there were different risks facing the electric system business. What we wanted to do was create a plan that enabled us to continue to demonstrate financial responsibility to the finance community, but also provide for rate stability for our customers for as long as we could within that confine. We ended up with a plan that we're presenting today that has three components to it. The first is to align our electric system rates with the cost to provide service, and that's by customer class. And so we look at our cost of service and we break down our cost to provide service to electric system customers by individual class of customer, and we have a requirement, a regulatory requirement, to provide to ensure our rates are aligned with the cost to provide service by class. We also look at our fuel rate in connection with this proposal and better align our fuel rate with our actual fuel expenses in the electric system. Second objective is to prepare the utility for the future. It's to support economic development, to find ways to continue to grow our business as our community grows in terms of the electric system, and then to also position our balance sheet better ahead of coming environmental regulations. With the change in the administration last week, the Clean Power Plan in particular may have a different path than we might have expected prior to the election, but there's still a whole alphabet soup of environmental regulations facing the electric system that will be challenging from a financial perspective in the future. This plan lets us pay down $190 million of debt early, which positions our balance sheet better to provide flexibility in the future. And the third is to create bill stability for customers. So if this plan is approved by the board, it lowers rates immediately for all customers today and enables us to keep rates stable for customers in the electric system, our base rates for at least the next 5 years. By doing this combination of rate adjustments, by paying down debt early, by increasing base rates just a little bit, by doing this package of financial restructuring, we're actually able to net save our electric system customers $100 million over the next 8 years. This page is a look at the changes in the electric system tariff rates. Because this is a public hearing to change the electric system tariff, I thought it was important to provide the summary of the changes in the tariff. So what this does is lists the former tariffs in the electric system, crossed out and overlays the new tariffs under this proposal next to them. And outside of the public hearing, we'll also consider changes to the fuel rate. And so we've listed those side by side so that net-net, you can see here that every rate class within the electric system will be receiving a decrease as a result of this package of actions. So to summarize, there's four items that we're proposing for separate action from the board. The first is the changes to the electric system tariff, which change the electric system base rates and provide for an economic development rider. The second, outside of the public hearing, is the fuel rate decrease. The third is the authorization to release excess reserve funds to pay down debt during fiscal year 2017. And the fourth is a delegation of a refunding authorization that'll allow us to accelerate that debt principal that gets us to the $190 million debt pay down early. As we get to the non-public hearing items, I'll recap each of those individually so that we can understand the differences and how they fit together. Any questions on the public hearing item or the changes to the electric system tariff?
Any questions?
I have a question, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Howard.
I have a question regarding the economic stimulus tariff. I didn't see a definition in the board materials of new load. So there's some discussion amongst Jerry Malott's crowd about the appropriateness of incentives to retain existing employers when they're talking about the incentives to attract new employers. As I understand it, new load under the tariff would only apply to someone coming into the community. An existing employer would not be changing their existing use to become eligible if they're saying, well, we're going to move to Alabama or Georgia or South Carolina because we have greater incentives there. That would not make that existing employer and JEA customer eligible, correct?
That's correct. Under the tariff documentation, the way that the tariff is worded is not only is it new load, but it's new load that if we take advantage of that rider in the tariff would not be served by JEA but for the use of that rider. Okay. So not only is it new load, but it's new load that's coming here because of our ability to offer that.
So maybe expansion by an existing JEA customer qualifies new load? They're doubling the size of their plant?
I don't believe that's that qualifies under the tariff, but
okay.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No.
Can you say it louder, please?
For the record, Ryan Wanamaker, Director of Financial Planning Analysis. So that would qualify. If they were doubling the size of their plant, for example, that would qualify as new load under that tariff.
Thank you, Ryan.
Thank you. Apologize for misspeaking.
That's all right. I'd just like to add, Mr. Chairman, kudos to Melissa and her team. Anytime you can lower rates for our customers, prepaid debt, and achieve stabilization for 5 years, that's pretty good. Pretty good accounting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Comer.
So just one question on how everything interlocks together. So I understand there has to be separate votes that kind of take place, one for within the public hearing and then three outside. But given part of this is, and what I find very attractive is the piece also that we're saving the customers $100 million over 8 years. Is there a way that that's lockboxed in a way where, you know, a future board can't say 6 years into that, I want to stop using the savings to pay down debt, or because it's not one agenda item and the fact that it's split into four different actions?
That's a great question, and essentially, yes. That's the fourth item that the board is considering is a delegated resolution that allows us to advance refund debt. So it's putting debt principal, it's actually scheduling debt principal into the early years, which will force us to have that higher debt service obligation and do that pay down. The other interesting thing about that advance refunding is in today's interest rate market, it's actually for savings. So not only does it force the principal and demonstrate to the investor community that we are serious about it, and we are committed to it, and we are financially committed to it, but it also generates some positive economics for our customers too.
Mr. Chairman, if I might just add to that point, that was one of the core principles that we used in defining this plan, that with this action and with the movement of the rates and the debt, that all of this money was held and directly, dollar for dollar, used to pay down debt. And so there really isn't anything in here for operation maintenance and other expenses. It's focused in the total plan to pay down debt.
So you're saying it's already
set up for that?
Through the plan now over the next 6 months to advance refund the debt? Yes.
Scummer?
Okay, so I'm clear. We're paying down the debt. We're making payments against the debt over the 8 years, or we're doing it all up front?
A little bit of both. What we're doing today is it's a slight increase in base rates, a decrease in fuel rates that more than offsets the increase in base rates. We're using that increased base rate revenue along with funds on hand to do a one-time pay down of debt of $69 million this year, and then an advance refunding of debt, which brings forward scheduled principal payments from the next 8 years into the first 4 years. So we're doing both.
Okay. And I think to Mr. Howard's question, there is also an additional economic development plan. So entities that are local and even that come from outside do have the opportunity to take advantage of the economic development plan, which provides a significant discount. Although over 5 to 7 years, you essentially grow into the retail rate, but the discounts can be as much as 30%. That is for load and jobs, and there are criteria to achieve that. So it's sort of, this is sort of that next step for the bigger, larger load generator, job generators and negotiation. But there is a good program that fills the gap between the program before the board today and retail rates.
Ms. Dykes, before we adjourn the public hearing, if I'm a JEA customer today and want to just kind of like a takeaway sentence, could you confine the results of your report there to the fact that we're going to have a rate decrease for so many years rather than $100 million for 8 years? I mean, when is the rate effective? When would it be effective?
The rate's effective.
What does it really mean to the ratepayer?
What it means to our customers is for bills that go out after December 1st, they'll all see a decrease in the amount that they're paying for electricity, and they'll get better stability over the long term.
And to Mr. Cumber's point, that's at least the five-year period that we're talking about.
Yes, sir.
Any other questions or comments? I'm going to adjourn the public meeting, and we're going to vote one at a time on these action items. You'll see number 3A is where we are now. Public hearing to modify. We are now implementing. I need a motion and a second to implement the plan.
So moved.
Okay, through the chair, that's resolution 2016-15 that's being addressed during this motion.
2016-15. Thank you, ma'am.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. Further discussion from the board. Mr. Burr.
Chairman, I just want to say, since I was chair of the chamber back in the horse and buggy days, we've been working on trying to find a way to help JEA to help us recruit businesses, and I think in addition to be able to doing that with being able to get a rate reduction to our residential customers is a great feat in addition to what Mr. Howard said
right
about the financial side, so I fully support this.
Other comments? Ready to vote on the motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Okay, we passed that resolution 2016-15. We're now on strategic discussion of the electric system. That's Ms. Dykes as well. Ms. Dykes?
Thank you. The next item for consideration by the board is behind tab 5B2, and this is the fuel charge reduction. The proposal in front of the board is to reduce the fuel rate from $36.75 today to $32.50 effective December 1st. This reduction would better align fuel revenues with fuel expenses in the electric system and would allow us to adjust our fuel fund balance closer to our target balance over time.
Why don't we get a motion on the floor?
Second.
Got a motion and a second, and we'll have the discussion and questions from Ms. Dykes and Paul if anybody has anything. Any questions?
This means we'll reduce our tendency to accumulate excess fuel charge funds and one-time rebates to customers?
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, like sign. We've approved. The next item is 4B.
This is the third component of the capital structure strategy. Within, behind tab 5B3 of your binder, you'll see an agenda item summary. And if you'll flip to the second page of the summary, I think this is the best place for us to talk about this item. The second page at the top shows the sources of funds that will be used for debt pay down for a one-time debt repayment during fiscal year 2017 of $69 million. The first line item in the source of funds is $12 million from the debt management rate strategy rate stabilization fund. That's the overfunded amount in that fund as a result of refinancings and debt structure changes over the past 10 years or so. And so releasing that amount would allow us to get to the target balance in that fund. The second line item, the $4 million, is an overfunded amount in the debt service reserve fund that is overfunded for the same reason. As a result of refinancings of debt service, we have lower overall debt service and therefore a lower overall debt service requirement. That second item does not require board action at this time. It's only the first line item that the board's considering for action. The remainder of the line items that are in this list of sources of funds are generated from fiscal year 2016. So those are line items where 2016 revenues were in excess of budget or expenses were below budget. And those differences allowed us to accumulate a source of funds for debt repayment during this fiscal year.
Questions?
Move approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, like sign.
I want the record to reflect that Ms. Kessler was not here for the vote, but there's still a quorum of five for the vote.
Thank you, ma'am. We're on 4C. Another action item to be presented by Ms. Dykes. Ms. Dykes?
Last but not least, this one is behind tab 5B4 in your binder. And this is a delegation, a delegated resolution to allow us to do the refinancing to accelerate debt principal into the early years in the electric system. We currently do our refinancing activity under delegated resolutions. We have a delegation for 2 years. That delegation expires on December 31st of this year. And so you'll likely see another package of delegated resolutions coming before you for general delegations in December. This is a very specific delegation, and the reason for a different delegated resolution is it potentially falls outside of the delegated resolution parameters that have already been delegated to staff. The way that generally the delegated resolutions work is they delegate specific criteria that staff can then use to execute real time in the capital markets rather than having to bring back actions to the boards, which would be impractical given how quickly capital markets move. If you'll flip to the agenda item itself, we summarize in here the parameters that are being delegated to staff to execute this refunding. And this refunding is expected to generate positive present value savings. In fact, today's market, sort of surprising since the election, we're up to about 7% present value savings. So there is some economic upside to doing this in addition to the business reasons to wanting to accelerate debt principal. What we've delegated here is the total amount through two resolutions. One is for senior debt and one is for subordinate debt, and that breakdown between senior and subordinate will mirror the bonds that are being refunded. We've broken down the total amount authorized, the maturity that's allowable, and maximum cost and certain call features of the bonds. I'm happy to answer any questions about any of the specific delegations, and I know the documentation itself was emailed given the volume.
Thank you, Ms. Dyke. Let's get a motion on the floor, a motion and a second, please.
Mm-hmm.
Have a motion and a second discussion. Mr. Howard.
I'm sorry.
Mr. Howard, don't be sorry.
He's got questions. I'm looking at the staff analysis that was presented with the resolution, and I'm confused by a statement just prior to the recommendation on page 2 of that staff analysis. It states that it's possible that the refunding of the bonds, may result in net present value DIS savings. I may have missed that day in vocabulary class, but DIS savings sounds like we're not saving.
It's possible.
Okay.
It recognizes that we're doing this refinancings for reasons other than economic savings. It's a really nice addition to it that we happen to have economic savings right now. But since we can't predict where the market's going to go between now and about 6 or 8 weeks from now when we can actually execute on this, we allowed ourselves the flexibility in the delegation to recognize that although we may not have positive present value savings, that's not the primary reason that we're doing this. And so it would allow us to continue to move forward even without that.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying.
Other questions? If not, we'll vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Okay, pass that item as well. Next item is for information only. Ms. Dykes, strategic discussions. No, we have, one more action item. I'm sorry, Ms. Dykes. Fiscal year operating budget line item change.
This one is unrelated to the multi-year capital structure strategy, but before we leave that, after closing a year of work, I just wanted to say thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the board members. We just lowered bills for all JEA customers and saved our customers $100 million, and that's a good day. Thank you.
That is a good day. Thank you.
Not every day I get to do that. The next item is behind tab 5B5, and this is really an administrative item. This closes some accounting adjustments that are needed as part of the budget for the last fiscal year. At the last board meeting, the board approved delegations for transfers within the budget to the managing director up to a certain amount. And with the stipulation that transfers needed for year-end exceeding that amount would come back to the board for ratification. That's similar to the delegation that was provided to staff last year, and so this is the ratification of those year-end transfers. There are three transfers that are being affected to close out the budget for last year. The first is in the electric system. It's a $54 million transfer to the capital fund. And that's the $54 million is generated by savings and specific other line items in the budget. And so it reduces those line items and increases the capital fund line item to balance the budget for last year. That is the largest source of funds for the one-time debt repayment that's part of the capital structure strategy for this year. So it sounds like a big number, but we're actually going to be using it for debt pay down within the next 30 days or so. In the water and sewer system, there's a $10 million transfer to the capital fund, again, generated by coming in under budget on a variety of other line items within the budget, and a $5 million transfer to the capacity fees fund. That capacity fees fund has to exactly reflect the amount that we've collected in capacity fees, and so that transfer trues that up for the fiscal year.
How about a motion?
So moved.
Second. Discussion. No discussion. We'll vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Thank you, Melissa.
Thank you.
One more.
That's it. One more. This one's for information only. This is a recap of our fiscal year 2016 financial results. And as a chief financial officer, this one's pretty fun for me too, because fiscal year 2016 was a great year in terms of financial performance. In the first page of this presentation, what my team did is took each of the key financial metrics that the rating agency analysts look at to evaluate financial health and stacked them up for the last 5 years. And what you can see on this page is we outperformed significantly across the board in every metric in both systems. From debt service coverage, where we've got the highest debt service coverage we've had in the last 5 years in both systems. Our debt to asset ratio continues that step down, which is great. Our liquidity position and our days of cash are both very healthy, better than they've been in the last 5 years. So these meetings in December when we get to talk to our credit rating analysts are going to be pretty fun, because sharing these results is just really outstanding. And in fact, the consistent results year over year for the past 5 years is what's enabled us to do the restructuring that we just approved and ultimately save our customers $100 million. Sorry, I keep saying that. It's kind of fun.
Big numbers. That's good.
I'll quickly go through the rest of the results. In the electric system, our sales were up about 1% year over year, primarily driven by an exceptionally hot summer. In terms of financial metrics and results, total revenues actually came in under budget by about $34 million. That was driven by the fuel credit that was done early in the last fiscal year. On the expense side, one line item I'll draw your eye to is the operating and maintenance expenses, which came in less than $1 million over last year for fiscal year 2016. That's including unexpected outage expenses, our tropical storm Hermine, which was in the last fiscal year, and pension and healthcare costs. Pension and healthcare costs alone were $3 million greater year over year. So we were able to exercise some discipline to offset the vast majority of that in other parts of the business, and that's encouraging. From a net revenues perspective, we're $91 million over budget in net revenues last year as a result of the combination of those efforts. Capital was $150 million, and debt service came in just under budget at 171 as a result of favorable market conditions. From a cost metrics perspective, on the bottom left, you can see we achieved our cost metric for the fiscal year, and we ended the year with $180 million in the fuel fund on the bottom right. In the water and sewer system, our water and sewer system sales were up 5.2% year over year. It's very significant growth in unit sales in water and sewer, driven by irrigation. Again, that hot, dry summer and had a lot of people watering yards last year, and we saw that in sales. For the year, the result is our revenues were $32 million greater than budget for the year. O&M expenses were up a little bit year over year. They were about $3 million higher, more than $8 million below budget in the water and sewer system. But some of the drivers of the year over year increase in the water and sewer system were, again, pension and health care costs, which were half of that. The rest of it was a whole host of miscellaneous line items, the largest of which is higher insurance expenses. Capital, $147 million for the year. And you see that growth in capital from 15, we're 100 million, we're 147 last year. We expect to be north of 190 this year. So it's very significant growth in the capital plan, driven by growth in the system and debt service at 95 million. From a metrics perspective, we missed on the water metric, and we made the sewer metric, and from a cost performance perspective. Debt service and debt to asset ratios, not much change in these charts since last time we've reviewed them. We continue to see that really good progress toward a healthier balance sheet, getting very close to median in the water and sewer system on the right-hand side of the page, still quite a ways away from median in the electric system. Combined debt, weighted average interest rates, 3.9%. That's been helped by a favorable interest rate market over the past several years. The bill comparison page has changed a little since last time it was presented to the board. The driver of the change is in the electric system, we annualize our fuel credit, recognizing that it's a benefit to customers in terms of total cost for the year, but it only shows up in a single month. So we annualize that for the comparison. When we got to the end of the fiscal year, we dropped off the annual fuel credit, but this doesn't build in the new rate structure. And so you see that change in our relative position in the electric system, no change in position in the water and sewer system. The last two pages in this package are the pages that we present to the rating agencies each year. And what we do when we talk to the rating agencies is show them the projections that we had for the prior fiscal year. So when we went up there in December of 2015, we told them we thought we would end up for fiscal year 2016, and we compare that side by side with the actual results for 2016. As you can see on this page, we outperformed in every single metric that we showed them last year, which is really exciting. We outperformed in coverage, in liquidity, our debt to asset ratio is better than we projected. Sales were up compared with a downward projection. Capital was right on, and base revenue was up. And so it's just great to be able to report back to them. And very similar story in the water and sewer system. We outperformed on every single metric in the water and sewer system. Any questions on the 2016 financial performance?
They're going to be impressed.
It is a good thing.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Melissa, before you leave, I wanted to tell you that one of the things I've learned along the way is if I want somebody to understand what I say or hear what I say, I usually tell them three times. Tell them what I want them to hear. I tell them what I'm told them, and then tell them again. So I'm going to tell everybody again that we reduced the rates, a terrific probably precedent experience for our customers and us at the JEA. And it really is a testament to the work that goes on here. I think it's a team. It's a good day for the team, and we appreciate it. Believe me, we do. And I'm sure our customers appreciate it as well. So thank you everybody else at the JEA. It's a good day.
Thank
You're
you.
Right.
How much did we reduce the rates by, Melissa?
We reduced rates by as much as 5%, depending on customer classes, and we saved customers $100 million over the next 8 years.
That's the number. That's the number.
Where is this coming? The next item on your agenda is the open discussion that Paul and I generally want to have a discussion about things that maybe he and I are talking about that we hadn't talked about at the board or not on the agenda. So, Paul, why don't you, I know you've got a couple of things you want to bring up, and I have a couple of things, not about the rate decrease, but some other things we can talk about.
The fact that we're save our customers $100 million?
Please proceed.
I just would say I'm glad to see that Melissa and her team have cleaned up after the last individual that had that job and really has things going in the right direction.
We love you, Paul.
She's having too much fun. There were three or four things I just would mention and maybe discussion, and I think we're scheduled for a committee meeting and then a full readout in the December board meeting from Mr. Howard's committee on government and legal affairs, but just know the election, we were fully prepared, contrary to some reports in the media and other places, we were fully prepared to deal with the Clean Power Plan. We had plans that ranged from a short-term implementation to a long-term implementation, and the difference with all of that is cost, and it's just how much and how long can we continue to keep our costs where we are before we dealt with such a significant change in our operating structure. But we were well prepared, and sort of the vote at the national level changed that for us, and now we're going to watch and see in terms of the implementation of clean power, renewable portfolio standards, et cetera. There is some talk about a repeal of it, but all of that's got to be put together in terms of where it sits within the court, the legal structure, the regulatory structure, and actually the legislative structure, and I guess we would throw in some executive orders. But we're on top of that. We're watching it closely. Clearly, the election will have implications, and the pace of change in the environmental and the regulatory rules are different today than they were last Monday. The outlook as well for tax policy, a lot of times we don't think about tax policy with respect to JEA, but it has the potential for a major impact on how we borrow, where we borrow, and at what rate we borrow in terms of potential, at least proposals for tax policy changes in the future. And a lot of that has to do with the municipal debt market. Does the municipal debt market survive as sort of federally tax-exempt investment vehicle or not? And if it does, at what level? So we have that. We've been studying that and involved with that at the national level. I've done a lot of work with our national organization, with federal legislators, both on the House and the Senate. We'll continue to keep an eye on that and inform the board as we go forward. We may want to partner clearly with the city, and we do that at the national level in terms of the cities and states from a financing perspective. On the local level, we heard a little bit earlier about the solar amendment, but just at the local level in Duval County, the Amendment 1, and this is the state Amendment 1, 248,509 citizens of Duval County voted in favor of Amendment 1, or 59.6%. So it did pass. And I would say, too, in terms of just depending upon the context, when you look at the state level, 51% voted yes. So you'd have to say that it received a majority. It did not achieve the hurdle of 60% to go forward, but a majority did vote in favor of that. And so our plans were to continue to assess that. We'll work with the Public Service Commission. We'll look and see what the reaction of the investor-owned utilities, and they sort of drive that state policy anyway, through the Public Service Commission, and probably in the early spring bring something back to the board for that, as well as looking at the demand rate structure that I think Melissa had put on the follow-up calendar for rates in her presentation. So that's a real high level of the and a couple of keys to watch coming out of last Tuesday's election. We're going to issue a calendar, I guess, and that was part of the discussion. We have the legislation going through the City Council charter change, moving from a required 12 meetings to a required six, not just six meetings, but a requirement for six. And so we're gonna ask that everybody at least mark their calendar for that third Tuesday, the same time and place, into next year, and we'll watch how the legislation goes through, and then as a group, the board can discuss, you know, at what time and place they would like to meet after that goes through. With all we've had, and I do owe the board some information on undergrounding of utilities, we have some white papers I've held back. We had such a tsunami of issues going forward and paper going forward. Just felt I didn't want to have it get lost. But in the next week or so, I'll send something, and maybe we'll put that as a discussion topic for the board at the next meeting. I look at that still. You know, the debate always is outages, frequency, severity. Underground, you may get less frequent, but the severity is significantly more. The cost, ultimately, $3 to $5 billion is what the white paper will point out. The fact that we would underground, everybody looks to just it being just a JEA decision, and it's not, because we have others and other utilities on our poles and have to involve them, and that's very, very complex. I think the other thing that we have to keep in mind, which is not in the papers, but we'll do some work on this, is that the whole distribution system of utilities is in transition and changing. And so taking and making any large investment at this point in time until that path is more defined in terms of both renewable generation on the customer site, as well as broadband internet overlying cables, where we are today, potential opportunity evolving for us. There's a lot of movement in this space, and if anything, caution would sort of dictate, I think, the next step forward for anyone attaching anything to pole or anything that has a wire above ground or a pipe below ground. It's just there are many, many moving parts from the different industries that are involved in having devices attached to our poles. And I'd say that's a national issue. That's not just a JEA or a local issue.
I think it's fair to say the poles are assets, right?
Poles are assets. Poles are assets. And in fact, we're having people, you know, approach us today and looking at attaching wireless devices and bringing broadband down, wireless networks being deployed through the community, and then we get rental income out of that. There are also emerging opportunities in terms of our broadband and our fiber network throughout the city, potentially connecting that with some small investments and providing a very large backbone for the community to get broadband far more distributed to businesses and residences. So it's really an emerging and changing landscape for us. But, I think two other things. Advertising, you've seen some of our advertisements more recently on television. We have a limited amount of funding that we're directing at TV. It increases impressions in terms of eyeballs on the content. Our mission in terms of reaching out to customers is to educate customers, teach and educate customers on how to utilize our services, how to save money, how to use our product more efficiently, and also to drive customers, help drive and signal them to lower cost channels. There's just an enormous adoption rate of our JEA.com and the processes we have through that channel, as well as our IVR and other automated channels, and customers like it. We get a higher degree of customer satisfaction for those that have driven to the lower cost channels. So for us to be out and speaking with our customers, engaging with them in that way, in a positive and constructive way, at an extremely low cost, we're getting a lot of hits in terms of eyeballs, but educating and driving customers to lower cost operating, which is good for everyone in the utility.
Excuse me, Paul. I don't want to take any credit for our ads. And I don't want to take any credit for Florida Power and Light stopping running their ads. But I sure am glad we're running our ads. And I'm really glad they stopped running theirs. I don't know if that's just good luck or what, but Oh, in case you hadn't noticed that, they stopped about the same time we started, so that's just, that's living right.
That's timing.
Timing.
That's timing.
Good work, Paul.
And as you mentioned, Florida, you know, in that part of that discussion, Florida Power and Light had a extremely large rate case in front of the Public Service right. Commission, $1.3 billion. I think they've settled down. I don't know that it's final approval through the commission, but with the interveners have settled it sort of an $825 million, roughly $825 million increase over the 4 years. And so I think that part of that was to cut back on their advertising.
Right. But, which is kind of an another interesting fact about us reducing our rates. They're raising theirs, right? Same
yes.
time we're reducing ours.
Yes. Yeah. The last point, we've talked about pension. Our plan in terms of the JEA negotiating teams, and we talked about this with the compensation committee, but have for consideration and dialogue among the board members another step from the board's perspective of supporting pension reform and really our negotiation of moving forward and trying to close up the general employees pension plan as it exists today and moving on to developing new plans for our employees. And we're doing that in lockstep with the city. The city has made their proposals. We are making the same proposals to our bargaining units. We've met with one. We've got three more meetings this week, and we'll clean up next week or certainly before the end of the month in terms of our negotiating sessions with the union. So I thought that maybe Mr. Chairman, you might want to lead this discussion with the board in terms of gaining support and providing us yeah. with some direction.
Yeah. Thanks, Paul. On the pension matter, we have a resolution at your desk there that's consistent with what we've done in the past as far as the JEA support of the general employee pension reform that's taking place at City Hall. And it's it says resolution 2016 at the top. This is a resolution that we're proposing that we forward to the mayor's office and present to our people that are in the negotiation and make known our continued support at the board level for the overhaul of the pension plan and the enactment of the new 401k for new employees. So if you take a minute to read that, and maybe we get a motion and just get some discussion on the floor.
Chairman, I read it. I'll move approval.
Have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Second. We'll wait a minute for some discussion. Mr. Byrd, did you have discussion?
Thank you, Chairman. You know, the resolution is that the closure of the existing plan, we're not really addressing whether, you know, the approval of the next plan or the defined, whether it's defined benefit, defined contribution of that. Is it just too early to talk about that? Is that why we're not part of the resolution to support the new defined?
Absolutely. So it's a closure, and as we are in negotiation, there's sort of we didn't want the board to step into negotiations, and so there's a little protection or shield there. But secondarily, the definition now of defined contribution and what that will look like, we didn't want to be too prescriptive. But that's certainly the path we're taking. I can share that with you right now. It is not any type of defined benefit plan. It's defined contribution. But we just wanted to make sure that it wasn't prescriptive and didn't limit us with even a better outcome.
All right, well, I certainly support yeah. this resolution. Yeah. I would also support it if it was took the next step and just said it would support new employees under a defined contribution plan without being more specific to that. But that certainly, because having nothing is, closing it is not a good thing without something substituting it.
Correct.
I would certainly support the resolution being expanded to include, you know, that being replaced with a defined contribution plan. Now, a defined contribution plan means a lot of things to different people, but it certainly would be broad enough for me to be comfortable, but I won't speak for my other board members.
Other comments? Mr. Cumber.
Is the 2% increase in current employee contribution, is that still a open item for negotiation, or is that part of the kind of the starting off point for negotiations?
That's still a starting point in terms of the unions would have to agree to that.
So is there a reason why that's the only item that we are weighing in on when it comes to specifics in the negotiation?
That was specific in the legislation.
That was, okay, yeah, that's what I was trying to get.
Yeah,
okay. That was what voters voted on.
Mr. Burr, I agree with you. I think what we're talking about is the timing of our support. Right now, Paul and I, based on his relationship with the process, feel like we need to continue to support from the board level our management to cooperate and work with the city negotiators on these activities, and they will progress, and we will be, I think, probably having more more precise comments and maybe more resolutions to continue the knowledge of our support.
As the board prefers.
Any other comments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Thank you very much. Paul, you have anything else?
That was it, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
I have just a couple of quick things, and then we'll get into our committee reports. The nominating committee of this board is a product of the bylaws of the board, right?
The bylaws and the governance documents.
Governance documents. This is my lawyer.
Keep her close.
She told me at lunch, by the way, that I have a second year and a two-year term. I just learned that. So I am chairman of the nominating committee. And I will, and in March, we need new officers. And I'll appoint the nominating committee in December, and we'll have a recommendation for you in January, and in March we'll be ready to go with our new slate of officers. So if you really have a burning desire to do anything, let me know.
Let Paul know.
Let Paul know.
That's right.
if you think you want to be chair, let Paul know. Okay. I covered that, right?
Yes.
I just want to remind you that we're going to New York to the rating agency meetings, the 10th and 11th, I think, of December. The mayor's going with us. The president of the council, President Boyer's going with us, and we're taking our key financial executives, and I'll be there representing the board as I did last year. So we're looking forward to that, and we think we'll be ready. Come back with another prize. Media policy, just to remind, and I'm really not talking to the board here, but I want to remind the board that we've agreed that the chair speaks for the board of directors on matters of inquiry from the media, and y'all are doing a great job, and I appreciate it, and I'm expecting more media inquiries, and I'm happy to represent you as well as I can. Everybody's doing a good job. Don't stop doing what you're doing. You're doing fine. I just put that out there for people that don't understand. Okay? All right. We talked about the ads long enough?
Yes.
Okay. I got that on my list, too. Okay. All right, we're down to committee reports. Compensation Committee. Dolores Kessler is our chairman, and Angie Hires is here to present. Dolores?
Thank you. We have the Compensation Committee has met. They have addressed the paper performance programs for 16, as well as the suggested and recommended paper performance for 2017. And we have four action items to vote on today. If the committee, the board, will look at 6A1, the first item that we need an action program on, is the fiscal year 2016 pay for performance program. and this represents the entire JEA workforce. Now, just to remind everybody our history on this, the formula for this pay for performance that we're looking at, we set up in 2016, January 19th, 2016, and we've been operating under that. Now, the results that we vote on today and recommend are going to be final pending the external auditors signing off on the JEA financial results, and we don't expect any difficulty with that after we see the expertise that we've got in that area, both on the board and working with JEA. And I also would like to say, I didn't even realize this, but the JEA paper performance program was introduced in 1990, so it's been in effect 26 years. This is not a new program and something we just dreamed up this year or last year. It's been around for a not long time. And it's modeled on a program that takes both the company performance as well as the individual performance, which I think is the best way to use the metrics and recognize highly engaged and a highly performing workforce. Now, the part that we're going to vote on here is an incentive when goals are achieved and the O&M cost savings are realized to pay for the program. So we can't go into debt in order to pay an incentive. The program is designed to incent employees to achieve and exceed established goals, as well as to focus on being good stewards of resources, which is key, and in turn maximizes the value to customers. The 2016 O&M cost savings, as operations and maintenance, was $22.5 million, which is a significant number. The earned incentive for 2016 is currently projected to be $3.1 million, or 2.2% of the 2016 salaries. So what I need is a motion from the board. If you found the program, the recommendation here in your book, it also has all the backup material for that one I'm sure you've already looked at. We need a motion that states that the JEA has achieved their savings of $22.5 million, and that is submitted, the board is submitting it for approval, or is going to vote on it, for the payout of the 2016 pay for performance program of 2.2%, and that number will total $3.1 million. And the comp committee is recommending that for a motion.
So moved.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor, discussion on the motion. Well, I can say the committee did yeoman's work on this. I'm on the committee, and we have the chairman and Kelly Flanagan on the committee that did a great job of evaluating this question, and the presentation and the recommendation is very appropriate.
Thank you. I agree.
No discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign.
Okay, now we'll
Item
switch.
2.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We will move to 6A2, and this addresses the 2017. This is what we'll be working on for next year. All the things that I just mentioned apply. It doesn't work for the entire JEA workforce and also will not be paid out unless the savings have been realized, and it's designed to incent employees to work on their goals as well as to be good stewards. If in fact we achieve the goals for next year, the targeted payout will be between 3.4% and 5% of salaries. So the committee is recommending to the board that you pass this.
Okay, let's get it. Let's get a motion and a second, then
motion
we have a discussion.
To approve.
Got a motion and a second. Discussion, Mr. Kessler.
Any questions? It's modeled around the same program we had for this year with the same, obviously, adjusted discussions.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Mr. Kessler.
Okay. If you'll go to section 6A3, this is obviously a similar program, but is strictly directed at our CEO. And this program that he's been working under for the last year was voted on in February 16th, 2016 meeting. And let's see. This is in your book and you've seen it. With the board direction and feedback, a prescriptive CEO scorecard was developed and approved, and the copy is attached. And I know you've already been discussing this because we had direct feedback from all of the directors, not directly with me or with the committee, but through our general counsel. Jody Brooks worked on this, we're individuals, so that everybody got to have a discussion and on a confidential basis. But, however, the way we decide this is at a general discussion at this board. So we are not saying this is a done deal. We want input from the directors at this meeting, and hopefully we will get that. By contract, the CEO is eligible for performance compensation of up to 15% based on annual goals and objectives that have been established by the Board of Directors and an annual overall recommendation by the Board. So what we need now is a motion to get this on the floor, have some discussion, and the committee, through evaluation, Paul's own evaluation of his performance, which we thought was, he was a little tough on himself, but we tried to correct him about that. And we would like to recommend that the 15% we don't think is where we need to be this year, but at 12. I went just almost upped it a percent there. 12.63% of his annual compensation. And just so you know what that is, so that would be a question you would ask, it will be $55,215, and that is not the highest number that he's achieved in the last few years. We've had numbers higher than that for the last 4 years. So this is kind of in line, but a little less than he has been receiving in the last 4 years. We're open for a motion.
Could we have a motion, please?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Discussion. Discussion on the motion.
Mr. Chairman, sure. Well, I would start by saying that I think I heard that we save ratepayers $100 million over the next few years. And that only comes from great leadership, not only from Melissa and her finance department, but really overall the entire organization and the entire team. So I think we've actually got a very talented executive team. I recognize that. And I tell you that directly, Paul. I work with a lot of CEOs in my profession, and you do a great job. A second observation would be that we compete with investor-owned utilities for talent. Right. The talent that generates, what was the number? $100 million, yeah. is sought after talent in the industry.
Yes.
And I'm mindful of that. Ms. Kessler can certainly speak to that from her years in the industry, that people will move for money. We think we offer a great opportunity for Paul here at JEA, but there's certainly competitors of ours that we dearly love to have the talented executive leadership we have. So while this may seem like an outsized bonus to some members of our community who may not make that much in a year, I will tell you that the benefits that talented leadership returns is far greater than this cost. So I haven't been as close to it as the Compensation Committee, but I've read all their materials yesterday afternoon, and I support the motion and the conclusion of the Compensation Committee, Mr. Chairman. I think we need to keep our talent in place.
Thank you, Mr. Howard. Mr. Comer.
I echo what Board Member Howard mentioned. You know, just kind of where, you know, where I came down on this is I do agree that I think Paul was a little harsh on himself, and maybe we didn't, you know, set up the metrics right in the beginning because we hadn't thought it through. But for example, on the, you know, reliability and environmental section, it's not like we got nothing achieved in that category during the year. Employee satisfaction, you know, yes, we kind of scored below that, but I think it's fair to say if you, you know, we don't get the opportunity to ride the elevators in this building and walk through the floors. But, you know, when you do run into people that work for JEA, they have a lot of positive things to say about leadership here. And, you know, it's I'd be more concerned if that came back, you know, where we had a 10% drop in employee satisfaction or something that was significant. So when I did my kind of independent scoring, I got to what, you know, I would say is a rounding error between, you know, what I calculated and where the Compensation Committee ended up. And so I'm very supportive of it. You know, I think it's important as we you know, for our sake, when we look at 17, you know, we just, and we'll get to that, is I just think we were a little, you know, this is the first time this board has sat through a scoring card where we've quantified the metrics. And, you know, to me, I think, you know, we need that flexibility in order to recognize that sometimes things are not on that scorecard. But we do need to be able to give Paul the ability to, you know, leave this table and go back to his office and recognize that this board, number one, supports him, and number two, supports the direction he's taking the utility in.
I would agree with both of your comments. I think you're right on, and I think we'll have another opportunity to get it right or better next year with the scoring and the metrics. As of September, this is a September 30th event, right? This is the year ending September 30th. So we'll start over.
That's right.
Ms. Kessler?
Right. Yeah, exactly. As of September 30th. This is only evaluating through
September. Yeah, so just kind of keep that in perspective as far as what we're talking about, as far as any changes we might have. Any other further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Ms. Kessler.
Okay, let's move to the next action item, which is the 2017 CEO goals. And again, the same things that we talked about with the others. It's based on performance and on measurables. And one of the things that Hussein mentioned about how we evaluate, we have addressed that and have not weighted our numbers yet. Isn't that correct? We're going to do 15% as far as that, but we haven't given our individual weightings. We're working on that.
Right.
In your notebook on the JEA board materials, there is a goals for the 2017, and there is a weight column. But at the compensation committee, this chart was modified to remove that weight, because the discussion resolved around all of these probably are not weighted equally.
Right.
So the compensation committee is going to meet again to talk through the various weighting. So mark through that column on the
right
in that tab.
Six A four.
But the total 15%, that's contractual.
Right.
But how they're going to be weighted and scored, there's going to be a compensation committee that's going to go back through that at a later time.
Comments?
Well, before we move this, as a point of procedure, I mean, that's not insignificant. And in the two areas where he failed to achieve anything this time, we're not, you know, our goals are either at or higher than they just were.
Right.
And, you know, I don't know what our timing has to be, so I'm asking through whoever is the appropriate question. Is it necessary to take action on this today because of some governance document? Or can we give the committee another bite at this apple and bring it back to this board for final approval once all the waiting? And I would encourage a better look at the metrics that we're measuring against, because, I mean, you know, I hate to see that he achieved. I think he outperformed some of those areas. To look up and see nothing's been achieved in those areas, I'd like to look at the goals as well, maybe give the committee a chance to look at those goals harder. So I would, unless there is something that mandates us taking action on this today, I know we're already into the new fiscal year, I would love to recommend or ask the committee to take another look at that and bring it back before our next meeting and see if they could look at both the goals and how the weights go, because I think they're both important.
Obviously, she will correct us here from a contractual point of view, but the clock did start ticking on September 30th. And what we really are asking you to do today is agree that 15% is the right percentage, and that we can readdress, maybe clean up some of the language in the various categories that we're looking at, and weight them a little differently. And we certainly can. None of that is carved in gold and concrete. It's the 15% by contract that we have to assure him we're going to look at. Am I correct on that, or do I need to be corrected?
You're almost correct.
Okay.
Section 2.2.
When lawyers say that, it's never good.
Right.
Yeah, I've heard that before. Right?
Section 2.2 of the contract provides a performance compensation provision that says the employee will be eligible to receive annual performance compensation of up to 15% of his base salary based on annual goals and objectives to be established by the board. And so their annual clock started October 1. So if there's not goals and objectives that have been established by the board, what is his annual performance compensation going to be set on? And so the longer you wait on that, it makes it harder either to achieve those objectives, or it doesn't provide guidance for your CEO as to what he needs to perform in order to obtain the up to 15% performance compensation.
Is there a way for us to address approving as is, leaving that piece out that defines those, and have the compensation committee meet before our next meeting in December? We're having a December meeting, correctly? Am I correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and then we meet before then, and then come back at the December meeting to fill in the gaps there.
My recommendation would to look at the goals and objectives, that left-hand side of the column. If this board thinks that those are the proper objectives, if it's just the metrics that you're worried about on the scoring side, that could come back later. So my suggestion would be approve the objectives, and then we'll work through the metrics and come back as Kessler stated.
I am happy to move approval of the objectives and the 15% cap in accordance with the contract, with the right to further visit both the measurements, sure, the metrics, and the weighting of those,
right,
those goals.
I'm second. That.
Further discussion? We have a motion and a second. Mr. Comer.
Chair Kessler, when you go back to the next compensation committee, the one goal that says fully implement sewer systems framework to resiliency.
Mm-hmm.
When I looked at the packet before, if I remember the timeline in the packet, it was to come up with a plan that would then later be implemented. So I just wanted to make sure that we are not setting a goal up where we're looking for items to be implemented that require capital that may not be available this fiscal year to actually address those issues. So if we could just get some clarification, right, on that one.
Good, valid point.
Any other comments, questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. We passed.
Okay, those were the own action items, the pension discussion we had before, so I don't think we need to touch on that in any way, do we, Angie? Are we good?
Nothing else covered.
Okay, Ms. Kessler, thank you very much. Before we leave the compensation committee report, I have a new assignment for you. Mr. Howard is right. If we were a football team and Paul McElroy was our quarterback and his contract was expiring in less than 18 months, I think we would be considering extending his contract.
Right.
So since you and I haven't had the opportunity to talk about that, I would appreciate maybe you putting that on your, now that you have dispensed with this subject to the largest extent.
Okay.
And maybe that's something that the compensation committee should address.
And I thank you for making sure we address that in an appropriate, timely fashion. And I didn't repeat what Alan Howard said earlier. But in my life, what I've done is work with CEOs. And I've worked with a lot of good ones and some not so good. And Paul is one of the best. He really is. He addresses everything, I think, in a very overall fashion well. His background in finance gives him an added advantage, and I think he has excellent leadership skills, and we'd be remiss if we didn't take care of keeping him on board and having him focused the way he is focused and the way we want to. So I want to publicly say I didn't want to sway the whole committee here as to how strongly I felt about that. I did say a bit of that in the compensation committee, but you're doing an excellent job, and I'm very proud to be working with you.
Thank you.
Well said. Any other comments before we move on? You didn't have much to say.
And that was perfectly fine with me.
See you next time.
Thank you. Thank you, Angie. She did all
Angie
the work.
Angie does all the hard work.
That's right, she did.
Angie, you know we appreciate it. Thank you. Job well done. Thank you and all your organization. Okay, we are on the manager and director's CEO report. Paul?
Mr. Chairman, I'll be brief to the board. I want to say thank you. The comments today and privately when we met one-on-one are greatly appreciated for the work and time and effort that we've put in here to build what I think is a world-class organization. And we started off on a bumpy road about 4 years ago with some metrics that we weren't really proud of. We embraced and engaged the full team at JEA, all of the employees. We built one heck of a management team here, attracting the right talent, putting them in the right place, and allowing them to perform with the appropriate level of incentives and freedom to act and create value for our customers. For that, I'm thankful. I'm thankful for the recognition that the board has sort of bestowed upon the organization through their kind comments today. So thank you very much.
So, Paul, you don't miss the 8-page scorecard that existed 3 years ago?
No, not at all.
It was 8 pages when I got on.
Oh, dear. Well, thank you for taking care of that.
We're making progress.
That probably gave me at least 5 days to focus on
my joke was the only thing we weren't telling Paul was how many times he had to go to the bathroom.
and going forward, I would just say, reporting on 2017, no moss will grow under the toes of this management team. Between now and setting the priorities and the weighting of the metrics, we've got the charge. We're focused on keeping expenses low, growing revenue, and realizing the full value of our revenue streams. Our capital investment plan, we've stepped up in terms of the infrastructure to support the capital investment plan. We're not going to make the mistakes that we made in prior decades. We've got controls in place. We're going to be real diligent next year in launching a very aggressive asset management program. Our reliability and environmental is key and foremost to customer satisfaction and value created to the community. Our employees being engaged at all levels, we've got some improvement, some work to do there. We're great in some areas with a workforce that's essentially locked up with long-term pension. You know, you hit some bumps in the road there, and we've got to sort of engage them in that 20 to 25 year seniority range and make sure that they're feeling fully participative in the workforce and things that we're doing here, and we'll keep focus on that. Revenue stability is key. We'll keep that going, drop that off, and really work and focus, as Brian laid out, with the plan for our water sewer business and making sure that we're more resilient. And we focused this year a lot on key stakeholders. There's been a lot of transition in our stakeholders at the local level. And now we've got the national and state level changes with these elections and continuing to focus on those, build and really leverage the capabilities and capacity around the board table today. It's really going to be important in the future as we move into those transitionary frameworks with a new legislature locally in the state and some of the activities that will be going on in Washington. So that's my report, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much for the past, but rest assured that we're a jet plane here and we don't have rear view mirrors. We're going straight ahead and we're going to be successful with this great team and produce great results for the community and for the board.
Thank you very much. Well said. Did we want to do that? Okay. I just have a few comments. Warren Jones is at his orientation today for his new job as school board, member of the school board. Said, tell everybody hello. I said, Warren, don't come back. We told you goodbye last week.
That's right.
So he just wanted everybody to know that he's going to miss you, and he's excited about his new job. I have talked to the mayor about his replacement. It's imminent. The replacement is imminent. Mayor understands how important it is. We have someone here, and he's on top of that, finding a good replacement for Warren. And I assume that'll happen, and go to the council and go through the process expeditiously. The media in the room, we would like to see us after the meeting. I will be available. I'll meet you at the flag right here behind me, and I'm available to anybody that wants to talk to us. And if I can talk to you maybe one or two at a time instead of 10 at a time, I like that better. You like that better? Okay. Maybe we can do better this week, this time. Do we have more comments from the public, or are we done with that? No more public comments. Okay, anybody have anything before we announce the next meeting and adjourn?
Yeah, one last thing, Mr. Chairman. At the last board meeting, I asked a question in light of the SSOs that we experienced during the storm about why we hadn't fully utilized our water and wastewater capital improvement budget from last year. And I wanted to report back to the board that Ms. Dykes promptly responded to me that of the $27 million in budget allocations to capital improvement projects that had not been utilized, for generators or otherwise, they were attributed to construction delays for the Greenland Water Treatment Plant, $13 million, Northwest Water Treatment Plant, $5 million, and Mandarin WRF, what's WRF?
Wastewater
something. $3.5 million. So over $22 million of that were construction delays. It's going to slide into this year. So it's not that there was budget allocated and unused. It just got delayed from a timing perspective.
Thank you, sir. Other observations, comments?
Chairman, the only thing I want to say is we follow the PSC and the investor-owned utilities as they address the solar situation, and we develop our policy. It's going to come back in front of this board, I assume, sometime in 2017. I think we will do this anyway, but it's if we can be sure we're maybe go one step farther, making sure we have all the public input and all the industry input we need in helping develop that policy. I think our last time around we heard that we didn't get a chance to comment. We didn't get a chance to comment, so let's be sure we don't have a similar situation this time. And no matter what we do, we may still hear that. Just make sure we document that well and give every industry and public a chance to have their input on that.
Mr. Comer.
And the only thing I'd like to add is, and Paul and I have talked about this, but I think it's important for the board to also recognize this. There's been some talk, and it's been in the press, about legislation potentially being floated this year in Tallahassee that would take municipal-owned utilities and actually put them under the PSC and take them away from independent boards and city council oversight. And so I've asked Paul to obviously monitor that and keep the board informed, but if it got to the point where this board needed to weigh in, my hope would be is we could have a discussion about that and discuss what would be appropriate. There may be challenges at other municipal-owned utilities. We don't have those challenges here, and so we just want to make sure that if a broad brush is, stroked in Tallahassee, we don't get caught up in it.
Well, it's going to be an interesting short term across the United States of America. We're going to have a lot of changes, so I think that's a good point. We need to be diligent from Washington to Tallahassee and to Jacksonville, for sure. Who knows where we might be a year from now. If there are no other business, we'll stand adjourned. Thank you. Appreciate everybody being here.